Good evening. This is David Hill. Let's talk about it. I'm having another show. We're talking about racial profiling today. I'd like to welcome to the show Mr. Andre Porter. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, happy to be here.
Okay, welcome to the show, Mr. Porter. And we're talking about racial profiling today. I know that you do get your own little thing that you do, and it interested me greatly. So let's talk about that.
Yeah, racial profiling exists in the black community. Deals with the police targeting the black community, whether it be through traffic stops, illegal searching of the homes, illegal taking of cars, illegal searches, illegal stopping individuals while walking down the street, you know, just targeting the black community in general. Quite some time ago, in 2004, the Niagara Falls Police Department was targeting the black community with excessive force on our kids and adults, illegal searches, and they practiced as far as police training and stuff like that was way above the law.
Well, I hear that they train the police to racially profile you.
Well, I can't really speak about their training.
I've had people in my family who have gone through the academy for that, and they're taught to racially profile us. And I look at what's happened abroad, around the nation, for all the killings and the shootings. They never stopped racially profiling us, which is the problem right there. It's how can we stop this? You can stop racially profiling us. And I know that you're actually doing this right here, and I heard that You had a thing with Governor Cuomo and Renee Kimmel then, who held a conference racial profiling that you've done.
Yeah, and like I said, in 2004 or 2003, Renee Kimmel is a congresswoman or altar woman for Niagara Falls.
Yes.
And Ms. Dosen is a close friend of Renee Kimmel. And at this time, Governor Cuomo came down to the conference center and invited the community to come down to the conference center right here in Niagara Falls by the Niagara Falls Convention Center. At that time, we was dealing with excessive force, landlord intended problems in our community. They noted that a lot of landlords was from out of the state, you know, out of the country, and they own property here, and they weren't keeping up to their property. That's why you got the codes and regulation at City Hall that comes around in black cars, you know, to see, you know, whether your property is in, you know,
working over, yeah. You got, yeah, the inspection, yeah, of the properties.
Right. Right. And at that time, we addressed our grievances to Governor Cuomo and stuff like that, et cetera. And then Renee Kimball, myself, and Ms. Dosen began to get our community together about excessive force on our kids and stuff like that. We then turned it over to the Civil Rights Bureau and stuff like that. We then entered into a decree with the Civil Rights Bureau, Assistant Attorney General of the Attorney General Office in New York State, which is the highest office in New York State.
Right, right.
You know, it's executive office. This is where we also entered a decree with the Niagara Falls Police Department. It says on here that they paid 26 of us, including myself, some money from a fund that the police department had for any suits that was filed against them. But mind you though, the funding come from funding where the police have been funded for the training, funding for the federal government.
Right.
You know what I mean? So they only took the money that they received from funding from outside sources and put it into a $110,000 fund, right, and it decreed. At this time, the police was supposed to testify at a hearing in New York State under this agreement, under this decree, right, the excessive force that they use in our community is searching people's houses in our community. Right. They practice as far as police training, as far as tickets that they was giving out and stuff like that.
But from what I hear, you said they never showed up.
Yeah, they never showed up to the hearings. The police never testified at the hearings. They also put another committee in process to have or determine the amount of money that was done by the Attorney General office. The New York State attorney, which is a county attorney for the police officers at City Hall, and he was present there too. He signed off on this too, as well. What happened as a result of them not following with the practice procedures and policies that they're supposed to implement and change under this agreement, under this decree, right? It turned out to be racial profiling in the black community, targeting blacks in the community, whether they be drug addicts or whether they be drug fiends or whether they be citizens in the community, whether they be motorists in the community or passing through the community. The Niagara Falls Police Department, along with any other police agencies in Niagara County, which consists of Town of Niagara, Lewiston Police, Deputy Sheriff Department in Niagara, Lockport, State Troopers, Border Patrol, Pro Officers, Deputy Marshals, Sheriff Department, and the surrounding counties, which makes up towns and counties. They began to target the black community too. By underdeveloping the community, a lot of letters was addressed to news people, Channel 4 News, Channel 2 News. We did an interview in my house on Lake Sale with Channel 4 News, the black community, me, Sheen, Popeye, Victor Johnson, Jabari Hill, my sister Sharon Rollins. In that interview, Mr. James too, also. These were some people in the community. At that time, we also had the community. I rode a bike in our community, and I had our community sign a petition about racial profiling, about police misconduct, illegal searches, illegal stops, pulling people over, which violated the Constitution, which was the Eighth Amendment constitutional rights, which is the Fourth Amendment right, legal search, stop, and frisk. They also, task force was also taking people to jail. There was also beating up our kids in our neighborhood, and they continue to beat up our kids in our neighborhood. So, at the first part of the petition, I didn't sign. I had people sign their names and their telephone numbers and their date of birth on it. The second time I went around on the bike, I had everybody sign their names and with their birth date and stuff like that.
You also have other people helping you do this?
Yeah, a young lady by Ms. Hayes, who stays on Willow Avenue, her and her son, which is a little baby about 4 or 5 years old. We walk from project to project getting these censures as far as racial profiling. What people seen or heard, seeing police going in people's houses, doing illegal searches in the community. Some of the women has been strip frisked in the community when they, you know, going to the project. Mm-hmm. They would use tactics like your child don't even live there on your lease in the project, and from the lease, your child's not on the lease, and they would use that as a tactic to go in there and say he was selling drugs out of the house and stuff like that, knowing that he was not on the lease. you know. And then they negotiated with the project authorities going there illegally. After they told you that person is not on the lease of that person that you're trying to go in there and illegally search their property.
Right.
You know, we have had incidents where in the community, in our community is only one target, not the vote. The vote is the dominant white community.
Right.
You know what I mean? Our community is dominantly black community over here on Holland and the Mid and stuff like that, et cetera.
Put it that way.
Yeah.
I understand. Right now, what was the outcome with meeting with the governor? What did they give you besides, you know, the monetary? What was there any agreements that
we continued to stop
to these things? I mean, did they was any of those things discussed?
Yeah, you know, it's just like the Indian said, white man speak with a forked tongue. They had agreement, they had an opportunity, they had everything in their power, you know, they're the higher authority, you know, some of the police officers now is being investigated, it's been 1983 civil suits in, at the federal level now. These are the civil suits at the federal level, Andre Porter versus Rodriguez, which was on the task force, who also Judge Murphy in Lockport, which is the chief judge in Lockport, also didn't believe Rodriguez in a stop and frisk of an individual. You know, we also believe that public defenders in this county, as well as the police, it's been influenced by the police to sell individual out in the county courthouse in Niagara Falls Main Street, and then shift it over to Lockport. We also believe that, and then again, the government fund, the district attorney in the Niagara Falls Public Defender Office is getting government money. They're getting funded to uphold the justice, you know, in the community. The district attorney is for the community, not for this. When the police do something wrong, the district attorney is supposed to prosecute them just like he prosecute any other individual in the community.
Right.
That's his job. His job is not to sugarcoat anything, to deny anything,
here's the thing. What things got out of hand, that is, they make the police officer judge, jury, and execution. I see it done. It's like a situation profile. And they do. And until you get in court, you don't have a say. But then until you're innocent, to prove guilty. I've been in the courtroom myself, and like I told the judge, there was no investigation done. There was supposed to be an arrest made. So, and what do I look at is kidnapping. Because when you don't racial profile me, or I look at this way, if you've done these things, that's called kidnapping. And they have to kidnap it, then they want a ransom. I mean, if anybody else did these things, they'd be put in jail. But it's all right for them to do so. I mean, these are the things that should have been discussed with them, with the racial profile and, I mean, these things and that fact. You know what I mean? What's being done to them? What's the repercussions behind what they do? Because here's the thing that our people forget. You work for us, but you've changed everything around.
What's very interesting to me is, after our communication, you know, every day I communicate with the governor's office. Mm-hmm. Every day I communicate with one channel news person or another. Every day they send me letters, right? This is from the Civil Rights Bureau right here, and that and the Attorney General office right here. As we discussed our phone conversation, the New York State Office of Attorney General remains committed to protecting and enforcing the civil rights of all New Yorkers. Mm-hmm. We take complaints of discrimination, including discrimination based on race, serious, and review these we receive with care. Please assure that the allegations of discrimination we receive from residents of Niagara Falls is given the same time and consideration. But if that's the case, why is racial profiling continue to go on in Niagara Falls?
Excuse me.
These police are targeting our black community. They're targeting our black community with pulling people over every day. Yes. You know, in the town of Niagara, is an accumulation of black. You could go get all the court records in Niagara County, in any courthouse, city, or whatever is geared towards the black individuals in the county. Period. Point blank.
So your goal is to...
My goal is to expose racial profiling.
Okay.
No matter who does it.
That's right.
No matter what color you are.
That's right.
That's my goal, to expose racial profiling. If a police officer is breaking the law, he should be dealing with within the law. All right? We had a police officer here in Niagara Falls, particularly a Caucasian woman. Police officer. She worked on the Niagara Falls Police Force. She stayed and was in a relationship with a known dope dealer in Niagara Falls. She lived with him for over 8-9 years. The federal boys came in here and investigated and said that she participated and she should be charged with conspiracy. But it's the same thing with Detective Rodriguez and the task force in Niagara Falls. They have targeted our individuals in our community. They have done all kinds of things that violate the Constitution and bars and violate their badge. They shouldn't even be on the force.
Right.
They have allowed black police officers like Tommy to beat up our citizens, the little kids in our community. You know what I mean? They continue to beat up our little kids in our community. They continue to take their cars in our community. You know, they continue to be racist towards our community. You know what I mean? We the only city in Niagara Falls, I mean, in New York State, don't have a community center for our kids. Yes. Our kids are out here killing one another, shooting each other. You know what I mean?
That's because
doing these things that they do.
They want to do with the money. The money has been there. I look into this right here, too. That's another show. But the money has been there. Now,
it's
not benefiting our community nor our children in the community. And when you went to court for these things and went to see these people, this was for these things to cease to exist and to stop. But have they? No, they have not. And still.
Also, we have videotapes of the police racial profile in our community. We have sent videotapes, numerous videotapes to the governor's office, showing where they had the whole house surrounded in our community. We had sent videotapes where they went in project areas in our community, and they got little black girls and little black boys racial profiling. You got the task force police there. You got the state trooper police there. You can go on Andre Porter at Work on YouTube, and you can see certain incidents with the police involving the police.
I like that.
Yeah. This is a constant thing in our community with the police. People in our community fear the police.
So what you say, if people need help, you would be able to help them in their crisis of need, you know, in their need, you know what I mean? Like, say if you've been racially profiled, they can come to you and say,
right,
what can I do? Well, you can lead them in the right direction and help them. Okay.
Right.
I love that.
We got a team. We got a team of people that goes out in the community and help the community, advise the community on their rights. We'd be more than willing if you could call in one of the racial profiling individuals. We'll come to you. Your number is 990-1275-251-7577.
Okay.
That is Victor Johnson's number. My name is Andre Porter. He also is one of the individuals that's part of the racial profiling.
Okay.
Jabari Hill is one of the persons that is part of the racial profiling. And then we got staff members that's part of racial profiling. Racial profiling also like to be known that we also film the police. We're more than willing to work with anybody in our community, you know, that's got something to contribute to our community, you know, that does not want to tear down our community. We don't believe in black on black crime. We don't believe in eye for an eye or nothing like that, etc. But we want the community to understand that we are all human beings, and that's not going to allow anybody to do anything. We the watchdog committees of our community. That's what racial profiling does. If you're breaking the law, we're going to make sure you get punished within the law. Whether it be a citizen, police, or whoever, all right? We're not telling people to go out there and do stuff to people and stuff like that.
Because they about racial profiling, what has been done to these officers that has perpetrated these
We demanded that these officers be fired.
Do they have names?
Like I said, we got the two or three black police in Niagara Falls that's racial profiling their own kind. They're beating up their black counterparts, Tommy, Officer Tommy, he know who he is, and another little black police officer. We have filed complaints with Gia Quinto, which is the professional standards investigator. None of the claims that we claimed that was going on in Niagara Falls we don't feel it was investigated properly, period,
right,
by him or whoever he sent it to, by their boss and all that. And then on top of that, when you go down to the police department to file a complaint, they don't allow you to file the complaint. You have to go to City Hall, and then you gotta get these little standard forms, these little small standard forms, ready to express yourself about your complaints against the police department. Also, they had these same standard forms at the resource center, because the resource center is being funded by the police. All right. So what we must understand here is that we got a police state. All right. Malcolm X said it a long time ago on Channel 7 News in 1965. What better way to discredit a black community, right, than making it look like, you know, the black community is criminal elements and stuff like that. We ain't got nothing but dope dealers, you know, pimps, players, and stuff like that in your community, a whole bunch of garbage, you know, and stuff like that. You know what I mean? History has a way of repeating itself. You're doomed for its death, you know what I mean? And stuff like that, etc. But like I said, it's the United States government, which is the highest law in the land, which is the governor office.
Right.
If you're not going to apprehend to what the governor's saying, the governor didn't mean this. Why did he sign the decree?
And made a decree.
Yeah.
But never honored it.
Exactly. My point.
No. And this right here was 2014?
It was 2014. They gave every individual, the 28 individuals on this document, they gave them money from the $110,000 fund, including myself. I received an amount of money from racial profiling me, you know, in the community. And it involved Detective Rodriguez at the time, too, just as well. And then this recently, I filed the lawsuit on Detective Rodriguez, right, for illegal stop and search. On Hyde Park, I was in a vehicle with a white girl, a white woman, all right, and he thought I was somebody else, and he falsified police reports and stuff like that. And unfortunately, I almost had a heart attack and stuff like that. I was bailed out and took it to the hospital in the ambulance from the police department. You know, and that's the result. And it took them a year to take me to court on a stop and frisk, and they thought I was gonna cop out. They gave me an attorney, which is a public defender, which I fired in court. And then they also put me in jail because I told them I didn't want a public defender. It's a conflict of interest. They worked with the district attorney, and I questioned them at the time about the decree.
Which they weren't supposed to put you in.
Right, exactly. And they put the following proper procedures and policies. Anybody that come in the police department, they got to understand they're supposed to ask them about their medical condition and all that and all that. And they're supposed to accommodate them with a mattress, treat them like a human being. The minimal standards of a human being, decency.
Right.
You know what I mean? They disregarded me, they illegally took me from a vehicle. I didn't get a traffic violation. The girl didn't get a traffic violation. They allowed Detective Rodriguez to illegally search the car, take pills out of the car that was supposed to be the girl's, escort her back to her property on Royal Avenue, right? Do a legal search over there, right? Violate her constitution, right? Don't give her a traffic violation. Keep the pills and all that, but take me to jail. Tell me that I had weed in my pocket. And I gave him the wrong identification with me having my ID in my what's the name, pocket. You know what I mean? These illegal tactics that goes on in there in Niagara Falls with the Niagara Falls Police Department. And then they did another incident with the James boy. He's way over on Tennessee Avenue. They take him out of his vehicle on Tennessee Avenue, take him all the way back across town to fall somewhere, right? And ask him for his keys. He goes in his pocket and give him the key to open up the door to his house. They talking about, no, we're not talking about them type of keys. We talking about the keys of dope. You know what I mean? They are forcing people. Keys
of dope?
Yeah. They are forcing people. This is Niagara Falls Police. But first of all, he violated his constitutional right all the way over there.
From his car.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Then you violated my constitutional right when you took a pass. I was a passenger in the car. They didn't even ask the driver with the license and registration. They came directly to the passenger side of the vehicle. They thrown, first of all, you violate the law by turning on your sirens. Okay, let's understand that first. You violate the law when you turn on your sirens.
And I was there.
Because you show a thing of authority for that person in the vehicle in front of you to pull over. All right, that's when you throw your sirens on in the police car, you're telling the vehicle in front of you to pull over. You violated a traffic law or a traffic violation. And these traffic violations got constitutional laws too that you must follow. The girl never got a traffic ticket. And then they try to say, Detective Rodriguez never pulled a car over when it's clear as day. That people in this community see Detective Rodriguez pull the car over, pull the girl out of the car, then go back to the car and illegally search her car. She didn't give him permission to search her car. What did you pull the car over for?
Yeah, first of all, give explanation about all that.
You see what I'm saying?
Why are you pulling me over?
Exactly.
Because that's your right to ask.
And then why would you be, if you didn't have anything to hide, and you weren't intending to do no evil intentions, why would you go to the passenger side? You're supposed to go to the driver's side, who's driving right. The car.
What a passenger got to do
with
the driver.
Exactly. Nothing. I'm just sitting in the car.
She was suspect, or he just wanted to point you out.
Yeah.
Except he thought you was somebody else.
Right. Yeah, he thought I was somebody else.
He's taking identity. We just think, first of all, you didn't ask.
Exactly.
I understand what you mean about everything. Mm. But I understand about the racial profiling of the police. But I'm talking to our people now, okay? What about the way that you do the same thing with your own people? How they struggle just like you, and you guys are trying to take what he has. That's the same thing as the police doing to you. That's racial profiling. Our people need to stop that too, killing each other off. Every time you kill off one of our black brothers, you don't just kill that man. You kill generations of his seed off. We'd stop that. So, stop complaining about the police. Stop complaining about yourselves. Do something better than what you're doing. Cause you're
but that all falls in with racial profiling.
Yes,
if our kids had a place to go to, like a recreation center, like they got in Buffalo, like the PAL, you know what I mean?
Or
community centers they got in Buffalo, or like in New York City, they got Ruckets. You know, feel me now, this racial profile, we got four black athletes in this town. Professional athletes, we got Johnny Flynn, Buck Starch, right? Mm-hmm. We got Rasheed Evans, the ultimate fighter, right? These are all champions out of our community.
Right.
They're not able to come in like all the other sport figures to the sponsor anything here like a gym or like a recreation center for our community. From the community which they came out of because they've been racial profiled here.
Right.
Paul Harris came in a couple years ago to do a thing right down here at the Dome. They closed it down, said that he can't sponsor anything through no party there at the Dome because of what? He's a gang member. When does an athlete that played for high school, you know what I mean, that all the city and everything praised at one time becomes a gang member when you know he was a basketball player? Played at Georgetown with Johnny Flynn. You understand what I'm saying? Johnny Flynn gives out turkey here, but Johnny Flynn can't get an organization here. He ain't no other stars, celebrities, and stuff like that that's willing to help his community. You know what I mean? But they're scared because of racial profiling. They're scared what the police want. You know what I mean? The police want blacks to go out here and commit black-on-black crime.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The police want to have dope dealers in our community.
Think about this.
You know?
Think about we don't even have communities anymore. Like it was for me and you again.
Yeah.
Because community also consists of more than just people. It consists of us on our own things. Yeah, think about today. How many businesses is inside our black community? One? That's it? I mean, we have black entrepreneurs, but they're not in our main district where we be in, okay? I mean, think about when we was young. I mean, we had our own Be Quick. Mr. Brown was the first black man to ever own a Be Quick. The first black man in New York State to ever own a Be Quick. We had different stores that you can go to. We had our own things for our community. We don't even have that no more. I look at the things that we have in our community now is a lot of churches that does nothing, absolutely nothing for us around here. Period. Why, what have I ever seen them do? Nothing.
Well, like I said, I think
it's a disgrace. Okay? Whatever happens to our black entrepreneurs? Why'd you leave? Or you just didn't want one of them? Or now we want our children to grow to be as we were racially profiled to be, drug dealers, just that. What happened to the brothers that sit back up doing something for our people? But this right here, where me and you come in at.
But what I'm trying to say,
what you're doing, I love. And what we need to start doing is a lot more of what you're doing. Which we have been doing. I mean, we got the African culture across town. We got a lot of these things that we need to come together with as a one and one accord. Because it's just more than just us out there. Mm-hmm. But we need to start to rebuild our community.
We need the help.
We don't need the police in our community in the first place. A lot of people don't realize that. Right. We can police our own.
Right, exactly.
We can teach our own.
Exactly.
We don't need these people.
Exactly.
It's time to vote these people out.
But we need our community to band together, stick together. Anytime you see the police conducting themselves improper or with illegal activities in your community, please pull out your cell phone. You're within the law. You can film the police doing something illegally on the property, on somebody's property, whether they have somebody's house around it, whether they beat somebody up in the street. Pull out your cell phone and any channel news, whether it's Channel 4, your local channel news, will be more than willing to accept your videotape if it's right there on the spot, okay? And the police cannot harass you, do anything to you, to harm you, or anything like that. That's within your constitutional right.
Yes.
So with that said and done, I'm going to bid all y'all good night. And I really appreciate the fact that y'all heard me out. And like I said, I'm sincere from the heart.
And I'm really thinking about
helping my community or being the best that I can be in my community, for my community. That means all brothers and sisters in my community. I'm asking you to stop your shooting of each other, stop your killing each other, stop fighting amongst each other, and stuff like that, etc. It make our community a better community. We need to stick together in our community, whether we be blood related or not. Stop your killing and think about what you do today for the future of our kids tomorrow. Thank you. Have a blessed day.
Thank you. Thank you for concluding the TV show for me. Appreciate you. David here, y'all. Yeah, have a good day.